Hello everyone. In this video, I will be exploring the cost savings argument, which is an affirmative argument on the Medicare for All topic, which is the September and October public forum debate topic. So I think this argument is particularly important in the context of Medicare for All, both because I think it's going to be a common negative argument in terms of the fact that Medicare for All will be a huge government program that could potentially cost, trillions of dollars. But I also think that there is plenty of room for the affirmative to make arguments that in the long run, Medicare for All would actually save the United States money. And so we're kind of gonna break down this argument, and I'm gonna explore two of the common link arguments as to why Medicare for All would actually save money as opposed to kind of cost a tremendous amount of money. So I think the first argument that I think is important to establish is, a uniqueness claim, which is just that the United States is currently outspending the rest of the developed world in terms of healthcare expenditures. So let's look at this first evidence from Crowley. So the United States spends more on health insurance than other wealthy countries. Crowley et al. 20, the United States spends far more per capita on healthcare than other wealthy countries. 18% of the nation's gross domestic product, $3.6 trillion, was directed to healthcare. Japan, the OECD country most similar in population size to the United States, spends less than half per capita on healthcare as the United States, averaging $4,717 per person annually. OECD data showed that healthcare utilization in the United States did not exceed that of other countries, and prices was a key driver of spending differences. U.S. utilization rates are similar to those of peer countries. Available evidence suggests that healthcare prices are an important driver of the high U.S. spending compared with other countries. So this evidence is good because, one, it is comparison to other developed countries, so countries with similar population parameters to the United States in terms of, the breakdown of the population demographically, how many elder people do you have in your country, right? These people probably will demand healthcare services more than others, right? So looking at population parameters and also looking at a per capita level, I think this evidence is a good job. But it also kind of looks and asks the question, is the increase in costs in the United States and the increase in the amount of spending due to the fact that Americans perhaps use healthcare more than peers in other countries? And what this evidence finds is that that's not the case, is that the United States doesn't have any kind of extra utilization associated with healthcare, right? So obviously we spend more than other countries, which I think right off the bat is probably kind of an important indication that the current system is broken, at least in some ways. So let's kind of go down the rest of the argument. So even despite these costs, the United States underperforms healthcare outcomes than other developed countries, right? So let's get this Crowley evidence again. U.S. healthcare spending has generally not yielded gains in health or productivity. Commonwealth Fund comparison of 2017 health system performance of 11 industrialized countries. The United States ranked last or near last in access, administrative efficiency, equity, and healthcare outcomes. Life expectancy is lower and chronic diseases rates are higher than those of peer countries. So I think what this evidence kind of shows is, despite the fact that we spend more than other countries, we're not kind of getting bang for the buck, right? We're not getting any kind of return on our investment. So this is obviously, a negative aspect associated with the current system. We're spending more and we're yielding worse health outcomes. So the next part of this section, I'm going to really focus on two ways I think Medicare for All would specifically cut back on and really save money for the government in the long run. So the first is kind of administrative efficiencies. So Medicare for All would eliminate the bulk of administrative costs, and administrative costs constitute 30% of all healthcare expenditures. So again, this is an evidence from Crowley. So the United States spends more on administrative or healthcare costs than peer countries. The United States spends $471 billion on billing and insurance-related costs, $375 billion. Administrative costs were 31% of total U.S. healthcare expenditures, and average administrative costs for private insurers are around 12.4%, substantially higher than Medicaid or Medicare administrative spending, which accounts for around 2% of total program costs. So I think this evidence really establishes uniqueness for the link argument, which is to say that it shows that one of the main drivers of an increase in healthcare costs in comparison to other countries are these administrative costs, things like billing, right? Other things like that, that exist due to the nature of the private health insurance sector, right? So if you want to think about it, when hospitals are, you know, if you go into the hospital because you say broke your arm, right? The hospital, you know, if you're insured, they'll bill your insurance agency. Maybe you have Medicaid if you're low income, so they bill, you know, the government, but maybe you have one of, you know, potentially hundreds of private healthcare insurances, right? And there has to be whole organizations within the hospital that are a part of billing, right? And there's, you know, that same counterpart in the insurance entity, right? And they kind of test, you know, did they receive this kind of care? How much does this care cost, right? And that kind of was what contributes and constitutes a lot of this kind of healthcare costs that a lot of other countries that have a more simplified and streamlined billing process through, you know, non-single payer systems. So, you know, through Medicare for All like systems, so like universal health insurance, don't really have these costs, right? And so this next piece of evidence kind of identifies some of the ways in which cost saving could happen. So single payer saves costs through reductions in administrative costs, specifically simplifying billing processes and bulk purchasing through government negotiation. Just kind of a caveat as well. Under the current healthcare system, the government is unable to negotiate with pharmaceutical companies for the price of drugs. So you'll kind of see this a lot of times in the negative argument about how price controls are bad for innovation. And we'll kind of discuss this in a future video. But I think this also kind of shows how the government will be able to negotiate prices from pharmaceutical companies, which will drive down costs to the healthcare sector. So this evidence is from Weisbart in 2012. So administrative access divert resources into activities that do not improve healthcare outcomes. Single payer model would eliminate the inefficiencies of fragmentation by converting public programs such as Medicare, Medicaid, and CHIP into a single administratively efficient financing system. Streamlined billing under single payer would save physicians vast amounts in overhead. Bulk purchasing to negotiate lower costs. Prices for identical products or services in the US tend to be, on average, twice or more than the prices of the same products and services paid in other countries. Prices are higher here because the payment side of the health system is so fragmented that few players have sufficient market power to bargain for lower prices from an increasingly consolidated supply side. Only a single payer system enables this kind of bulk purchasing of drugs and medical devices that would give the buyer power. So I think the first part of this evidence kind of does a good job of identifying some of the streamlining that would associate, that would come with a Medicare for All system in terms of, you know, establishing only a single payer, right? Hospitals will only need to bill, you know, the government under Medicare rates, whatever, you know, the Medicare reimbursement rate is. They won't have to kind of navigate the complexities of, you know, private healthcare insurance. They also won't have to deal with, you know, the billing department in the private health insurance counterpart, right? All of these things, you know, make the process more simple. I don't really think that needs quite as big of an explanation. The second part of this argument, I think, is a kind of an interesting link because it talks about bulk purchasing. So I think it's important to kind of understand the nature of supply and demand, right? So supply, the entities that are supplying drugs, so in this case, pharmaceutical companies, they're providing the drugs, they're selling the drugs. Then the same side, you have demand, right? And so what this argument is saying is that the supply side of the health insurance sector in terms of the drug market is monopolistic in the sense that there's few players in this industry. So they're really able to set prices kind of whatever they want to set it at, right? So there's pharmaceutical companies that kind of have monopolies over the pharmaceutical sector. So they charge an increasing amount because, you know, they have people that want to buy the product. The same side, demand is a competitive market, right? So there's multiple players. Nobody has a market share, right? So what does that mean is that, you know, no single buyer can negotiate for higher prices because let's say, you know, I own, I don't know, a hospital and I'm trying to buy a drug and, you know, I'm like, actually, I'm not going to pay, let's say $100 for this, you know, this set of drugs, right? Maybe I only want to pay $50. And well, on the supply side, they're just going to be like, well, look, I'm not going to sell to you. I'm only going to sell to, you know, this other hospital that's willing to pay $100, right? And so what Medicare for All does is it results in a single payer, right? It's only going to be the government that's going to buy from these sort of pharmaceutical companies. And so because of this, the government might be able to negotiate for lower prices of drugs, right? And so this is another way in which the United States could save money because right now, right, the part of the evidence indicates that The U.S. tends to spend twice or more than the prices of the same products and services paid for in other countries, right? So obviously, right, this is a key area in which you would see cost savings. Okay. So with that said, let's kind of look at the second link, which I think is more associated with the realm of healthcare in general, like healthcare outcomes. So Medicare for All invests in preventative care, investments in solving for preventative health conditions such as diabetes and obesity could save the U.S. trillions in dollars per year, numbers only set to grow by 2030. Increased investment in public health infrastructure would see massive returns on investment to U.S. healthcare sector. So I know that tagline was kind of jumbled, but I think the argument is pretty simple, right? The United States has disproportionate rates of preventable healthcare, diseases or, you know, other issues such as, you know, obesity, diabetes. A lot of these things can be treated if somebody goes to the doctor in the first place, but they also can be treated through things like lifestyle changes and things like that. However, right, a lot of people don't seek out preventative care because they either lack health insurance or they fear that it will cost too much money if they go to the doctor. So a lot of people delay getting access to care, and they only get access to care when it's already, you know, too bad, right? When it's too late, right? And so this evidence kind of indicates how, you know, being able to solve back for, preventative healthcare industries due to the kind of paradigmatic shift that would be associated with the Medicare for All system would save trillions of dollars per year through largely preventable illnesses that the United States disproportionately experiences in comparison to other countries. So Crowley et al. 90% of U.S. healthcare costs are associated with people with chronic medical or mental health conditions. The leading cause of death and disability in the United States and accounted for $1.1 trillion in direct healthcare costs and $2.6 trillion in indirect costs. By 2030, a total of 83 million individuals in the United States will have three or more chronic conditions, up from 30.8 million in 2015. Increased investments in public health interventions that target chronic health conditions leads to lower costs and higher returns on investment. Right, so I think this evidence is a good job. Another warrant that you might be able to find some evidence about, but I think it's kind of embedded in this argument, is just that, you know, when you have a private health insurance agency, right, they might not be able to like pay for like a preventative surgery because that'll cost them money upfront. A lot of these companies operate through short-term profits because they're trying to create a return on investment for their shareholders, whereas the government, they're in it for the long run, right? They want to, you know, show an increase in your health outcomes, not only because it will save money in the long run, but also because it's better for society, right? You're more productive, you contribute more to the economy, you're a better citizen if you're healthier, right? They also, in some sense, a moral imperative to improve outcomes for the citizenry or people that, you know, exist with inside the body politic. And so I think a lot of these kind of reasons as to why, you know, the government providing health insurance might be more desirable than private entities who kind of care about their bottom line, care about a return to shareholders in the short term. And because of that, they can kind of, you know, trade off with providing higher access to care. So thank you for listening to this video. And hopefully this kind of helped you with this line of argumentation.